when I did the Gaitonde retrospective, it really came as an academic idea. He was somebody that we all knew, yet there was no scholarship on him. His work had never really been seen as a retrospective. There had been no conservation done on his work. There was nothing known about his life. So I went to the Guggenheim with this idea of showing this really important artist from South Asia who was a great protagonist and a great teacher and a great, mentor. But we didn't know anything about his exhibition history, his biography, his bibliography, anything about his life. His work had never been written about in any kind of art historical way. And I convinced the museum to do it. And it was a very important show at the Guggenheim, which changed the museum in some ways because they were no longer just a Western institution. They were looking at global art and looking at non-Western art on the same footing as any kind of Western modernist. So I think in every situation, there's a different approach or a different methodology, but you just have to get it done. You have to be very persistent. And some of these relationships, they take 5, 10, 15 years to actually manifest, but you have to just do it. And hopefully you still have these friendships with the artists and you continue to serve them in different ways, like this lecture. Oh, and I also did a project called Being Single or Plural, which was looking at experimental sound and moving image practices from across South Asia. You might know the work of Amar Kanwar, you might know the work of Desire Machine Collective, you might know the work of Shomona Goel. They're all Kabir Mohanty, people who had been trained as incredible filmmakers. But again, even though Amar has been in 4 consecutive documentaries, his work really hadn't been written about or seen enough in New York. And again, over a period of 6 years, I was able to collaborate with them, acquire a lot of the work for the Guggenheim's permanent collection, and then show their work both in Berlin and in New York. And again, I'm still friends with all of them. So they might invite me to write a catalog essay for them. We might work together in a different way. I might help them to still get their work into different museum collections. These are not relationships that die with that project coming to an end. They continue because they matter to you. Okay, I hope that helps.
So, I have a question. Yeah. It was really enjoyable presentation. You mentioned that Zarina works very intimately with her body. She makes things that she can make. She doesn't have a team, erecting monumental. And then she embarks on this work, 10,000 things.
Yeah.
So I'm just trying to understand, is it like a, is she archiving or mapping the trajectory of her practice over 40 years in that piece?
Yes, it is actually, because a lot of them are old photographs of the family. I'll give you some examples. Some of them are miniaturized versions of the tasbis or the folding houses or the refugee camps. Other ones are, again, the discarded, what we would think of as discarded woodcuts, woodblock prints that she's reusing and creating, new weavings or new kind of drawings. So it's a way of her to think about her own life. But again, very inspired by Duchamp and the idea of an artist creating miniature replicas and photographic reproductions of their own work and creating these kind of portable museums. You might think of it close to like what Dainita does. Creating a museum through the 10,000 things. And she actually wants to make the 10,000 things.
Right now, there aren't 10,000 things.
But it's metaphorical also. It's an idea of counting and looking back at one's own life. I mean, when we did the retrospective, it's a very kind of cliched press question. So, Zarina, how do you feel about the show? You must be very proud. And she said that I'm actually extremely fearful because I've never seen 50 years of my own life presented in a single show. And I don't know how to deal with it. So a retrospective exhibition is not straightforward for the artist. I mean, Navjot is here with us. She's just got her show at NGMA. It's a vexed emotional space for an artist. It's not straightforward. We write of it in very kind of linear, chronological ways. But for an artist to be able to reckon with such a long practice, with earlier work, with more recent work, it takes them time to live with their own work. So she visited the show in all 3 venues very often so that she could just try to get some of her own understanding about her work. She had never seen so much altogether.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Though they are completely different from each other, Nasreen Mohammadi and Zarina, what is it that makes people draw parallels between them?
I think it's quite simplistic. The fact that they were both women artists. The idea, the question is about Nasreen Mohammadi and Zarina. The fact that they were both South Asian women artists, and some of the few that, you know, veered away from figuration and storytelling and narrativity and went into the non-figurative or the abstract space. And Zarina knew Nasreen Mohammadi. She was an artist that she was familiar with. But Zarina's entire inspiration came from the history of printmaking. You know, whether it was Japanese woodblock prints or whether it was Atelier 17 or her very, very close friendship with Krishna Reddy and all of his innovations with simultaneous intaglio printing. So her community of artists was A, the printmakers, or the artists that were really gathering around the feminist movement, like Louise Bourgeois and Anna Mendieta in New York in the 70s and the early 80s. And Nasreen Mohammadi has nothing to do with these. So I think very sort of simplistic visual parallels have been drawn between their practices, but they're very reductive and they're art historically completely incorrect.
Yeah.
And I only realized now when I chatted briefly that it was one of the very few shows I had of South Asian art at the Guggenheim. From what you described earlier, that a lot of the time, in a lot of instances, they had actually acquired the art and then they exhibited it.
Yeah.
Which for me, because I'm also curated in a different space in film, it's a whole other ballgame because it involves finances and convincing people at other levers of power. Is easier for you, for them to just have a curated respect and allow you the space to do it? Because the acquisition other number, and because I struggle with the same things, and also,
people who are big protagonists.
Just have somebody they respect do it instead of necessarily acquiring. Of course, it's fantastic for the artist to have a work acquired.
So, I'll talk about acquisitions first. It was very important for me that in those years that we were working on the Asian art program, that we didn't just do exhibitions because they come and go, but that we had to make an impact on the legacy of the Guggenheim. And the only way you really change an institution is through its collection. So part of my brief, or let's say, headbanging, hitting over the head to all of the senior curators was, we need to devise exhibitions which are also allowing us to commission work or co-commission work. And this is very unusual in a museum. This is something that biennales do. And we had an academic council called the Asian Art Council, and Jack Posekian, who's this controversial but very venerated curator from Jerusalem and Sharjah, said, but you guys are so passive, you only do exhibitions, you never really spawn new work and new ideas and new commissions like Sharjah. And I thought, okay, that's a great challenge, you've just thrown down the gauntlet, I'm actually commissioning everything. So it's very difficult. It doesn't happen that often. Shri and Priya, who are both leaders here, will tell you that to actually commission work, acquire them, and then show them and document them is almost unheard of. I wouldn't do it again. It almost killed me. But the fact is that today the Guggenheim has work by all of these artists. And the reason that they show very little about South Asia is that South Asia is a very young field. We have great scholarship on the pre-modern, but we have very little scholarship on the modern, and that's still true. People like Gaitonde, people like K.G. Subramanian, people like Nandalal Bose, you're talking about the earlier generation, don't forget about the contemporary, still don't have monographs on their practices. The galleries are trying to do this, the museums are trying to do this, but there's a vast amount of scholarship that still has to be done. It's going to take everyone in this room, young critics, young curators, young writers to really start to chip away at that. my work at the Guggenheim was the first time that they showed South Asian art. But there's a commitment now, you know, to show non-Western art, to show art from Asia. And it's now become part of the museum's mission. This is not something that's going to die just because I've left. But at the time, you know, the idea of South Asia was Anish Kapoor. The idea of South Asia was Anish Kapoor. That's where the knowledge started and ended. And it's nothing related to what we do. So being singular plural, Zarina Hashmi, Gaitonde, these were very important first steps, not just for the Guggenheim, but also for our field. And since then, you've had, you know, exhibitions happening all over.
Very senior in England, in London, telling me, why would an Indian do this? You know, so for me, it's interesting to ask you this question, whether a white curatorial community sees that they are the authority of everything in the world, including Oriental or Indian or Asian art, and a kind of patronizing, oh yeah, we'll also let some brown guys do some stuff. I'm curious whether these kind of undercurrents exist in the artistic sphere, because I experienced it so in such a brittle manner. I was astonished that an Indian curating Indian films would be seen as so contemptuously. Yeah. I said, whoa.
I think the field has changed. We're just talking about the lack of visibility of South Asian curators internationally. But, you know, I did these projects almost 10 years ago, and at the time I was the only brown person in the room. In fact, I was the only brown person in an institution of 350 white people. And as my mother knows, I wore a sari to every single opening. But yes, you do feel, but then you take the responsibility even stronger, you know, you take it on board. But the field has changed. You've got positions now that have opened up in various parts of the world. You've got gallerists and biennials and artists and writers and young curators and critics working all over the world. So it's shifted. You know, it's more taken for granted now. It's part of the mainstream. I think these titles are still ridiculous. You know, the curator of Middle Eastern art or the curator of South Asian art. These titles shouldn't exist. We should just be curators of international art or contemporary art. So the shift has happened. It's a field. Asian art is older than South Asian art. Asian art has been documented and exhibited, especially in places like Fukuoka and Queensland, for the last 25, 30 years. So it's happened in the region for longer than it's happened in the West. We just don't look at Australia or Japan, but in fact, we have to, because these institutions have been collecting from Pan-Asia for much longer than the Guggenheims and the MoMAs and the Mets. But the Western institutions now are realizing that for them to really be considered global, they need to re-educate themselves. That they are the ones who are ignorant, not us. And this has taken time. It's taken 10, 15 years. But the press is writing about it differently. The artists think of them differently. The museums think of themselves differently. And it's everyone in this room who has a part to play in it. You know, institutions like this. Thank you. I think that's it. Yeah, thanks.
So much. No, please join me in thanking Sandhini for a wonderful hour.
Thanks, mommy. Thanks for coming. Thanks for coming.
Don't do that.
No, I like doing pranam. No, I like doing pranam.
So good luck.
Thanks. Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. Really, really nice.
Yeah. Just thought.